This is Whitley Strieber, and this is a Dreamland video presentation. You have reached the edge of the world. Well, Dreamlanders, today we are talking to Alan Steinfeld. He's been a dear friend for a long time. He was one of the witnesses in the Pine Ridge Reservation to my experience of seeing into the parallel universe. And he's been a witness to many, many other things in his life. He is an explorer of consciousness. I think that's the best way to describe him. For over 30 years, he hosted and produced the weekly television series New Realities in New York City. You probably are aware of it. It includes interviews with all kinds of people, ranging from Deepak Chopra to Ram Dass, Marianne Williamson, every major UFO researcher, I believe, including this one. And if I am a major UFO researcher, or perhaps something else.
You are. You're the major UFO. Yes.
Well, thank you. He has emceed at Contact in the Desert. He has been very good to me in introducing me without mentioning the rectal probes jokes at any time, which has been very good of you. Alan Steinfeld, welcome to Dreamland. Today we're going to talk about his new book, Making Contact. All right, Alan, it's time for us to do this. And I want to start out, the book is basically a journey in essays through the world of UFO research, and we're gonna talk about the different researchers. We will not talk so much about this one, although I do have an essay in the book, because obviously we're going to be talking about Linda Howe, Grant Cameron, Nick Pope, Daryl Anka, John Mack's contribution, the Hertogs, JJ and Desiree Hertog, Carolyn Corey, and as many as we can get to. The foreword in the book is by George Noory, our dear friend. And I would like to start with something from the beginning of the book that Alan has written. At this critical juncture in the government's official acknowledgement of the reality of UFOs, UAPs, scientists, politicians, and mainstream news outlets have no idea what to make of these startling revelations are the outpouring of sightings and contact experiences currently being reported on a global scale. The book is the most comprehensive clarification to date about the intent and intelligence behind the phenomenon. The variety of viewpoints expressed in the volume provide a solid foundation for the preparation of the greatest challenge to ever confront humanity. Beautifully said, Alan. Now, I'm not going to ask you to expand on it exactly, but what is the government, what do you think the government is going to do with this enormous literature of witness?
Yeah, before I get to that, I want to say, Whitley, you have been one of the major influences on me in tuning into this phenomena. And we can get into my experience. Yeah, absolutely. You are foundational in this realm. So and you've opened up many people's minds to what this whole book is about. So we're getting hints along the way as this, everyone knows about the ATIP program and the 180 days.
Spell out ATIP. Okay. Let's back up a little bit.
Okay, sorry. So I'm sure a lot of your listeners know about the Advanced Aerial Threat Identification Program that the government – Is that good?
No. We're not going to edit this. We're talking to each other. Just as if don't think of that as an edit.
Okay, good.
I don't edit the show.
Forget, Forget it. Okay. But anyway, there was a program in 2007 that was instigated by Harry Reid, Senator Harry Reid of Nevada, along with a few other senators, to start to investigate what's been going on in the world of UAPs. And that was really the first time publicly and privately through Congress that the word UAP replaced UFO. So what I'm getting to is that the government has been dropping hints. So what is the difference between UFO and UAP? Well, UFO is unidentified flying object. UAPs is unexplained aerial phenomena. So we're going basically from object to phenomena. So what they're realizing, I'm feeling, in their investigations, that's, of course, secret, and maybe or maybe not we'll find out about that, is that it's this is more than just things in the sky. This, and if you look through the ATIP documents, they talk about cognitive environments. They talk about the effect of ETs and their craft on human consciousness. So this, even along the government standards, is starting to have more to do with consciousness, who we are, how we think, how we perceive reality, than the fact that, hey, we're having company, we have visitors here. So we have to push the government to start to reveal more of that. What is the phenomena? And somewhere in the ATIP documents, it also says the phenomena is now quantum physics. And this has been the recent testimony by Luis Alejandro on the news channel. So there's a quantum physics element dealing with consciousness. And of course, we don't really understand what quantum physics is. You know that great expression by Richard Feynman? If you think you understand quantum physics, you probably don't. But yeah, what were you going to say?
Well, when he says quantum physics, what he's really saying is it's a mystery, and we're using words to make it sound like we might understand it, which is not true.
But he's also saying, if you look at what quantum physics is about, it's about the role of the observer, that there is no objective reality, that it is a subjective experience in physics, in the observation of the world around us, and in this UFO phenomena. And so, as Grant Cameron says in that second essay in the book, there are no innocent bystanders. If you're seeing an object you've meant to see it, and it is contacting you and you're contacting that, and that is about an awakening of a greater degree of our minds. So quantum physics, and I think the ETs, whatever's out there, have been able to understand the intricacies of quantum physics and the direction of consciousness more than humans have, because we're just beginners.
Well, I wonder if we are beginners or that we have been cut off from our real past. I have a big, big question about that. Because when I look around myself at the world around me, and I see all of these inexplicable and ancient objects, such as Nan Madol in the Carolinas, the pyramids, of course, so many different things, the fortress at Sacsayhuaman in Peru, all of this is impossible construction. The massive platform at Baalbek in which was not built by Roman engineering, because we know how the Romans built things. We know very well what their construction methods were, and they had no equipment that could move those enormous stones. In fact, we don't have equipment to move some of them now. So, but it was done by somebody. Now, all of that put together, and then you add to it the extraordinary sophistication of the pyramid text in the Pyramid of Unas, which is the oldest religious text in the world, but I believe it is actually the last text of soul science. Something's been done here. We've been interrupted. We have been, G. Iger Jief refers to it as the introduction of something called the, he calls the organ kunda buffer, that is to say kundalini buffer. And we are energetically crippled. We can't address these energies. Now, what in the world is the government going to say, Alan, that about the abductions?
I know they have a lot of backpedaling to do, but just to go back to what you said about soul science and the use of consciousness, it's not just that these incredible structures have been built without any awareness of how they could have been done, because we've been disconnected from, I feel, a cosmic grid, a kind of interconnection to the cosmos that's been shut down by, maybe some people call them the archons. Maybe they were just...
Well, something happened.
Right.
Something
right,
happened. Let's talk now about Linda Howe and her essay. Tell us a little bit about Linda's approach and what she thinks and what she says in her essay about the moon and so forth.
I have to say Linda was very influential, at least in the prologue that I wrote about freedom, that Linda always talks about we are an enslaved race. If we do not know the truth of our origins, if we've been kept in the dark, we've been in an abused culture. We have been disconnected by the forces that don't want us to know the next level of consciousness. So I open the book with a kind of tribute, in a sense, to Linda by using a poem by an abolitionist from 1844 that says, "Now is the time for new experiences to break open within the human mind, for new foundations of truth to be brought out, for the evolution of human beings." And I think this has been Linda's approach. Talking to whistleblowers, she mentions in her chapter her 8-hour dialogue with someone from the Defense Intelligence Agency who told her and from the secret information he got, that we've been victims, in a sense, of three different extraterrestrial races fighting for control of this planet. And
well, something is certainly wrong.
Right. And Linda, I think, gets to the bottom of it because she reduces it in her talks and here to the soul. They want something about our soul, Linda says. And I'm not sure I agree with that, but because she, from what I've talked with her and what she said, some of these beings want our soul. But I think you have to have a soul in order to want a soul. You know how it's like the problems with AI is that they're only programmed, but they are soulless. So if some of these creatures are soulless, some of these beings, some of these grays even, would they want a soul? Because how would they even know what a soul is? But I think what they do want from us, and the people you've interacted with, is our capacity for the depth of soul feeling, for the depth of expression, for the depth of emotion. And this is the interface that I think we're working with now. And I think some of these ET races that Linda's been talking about, and you, of course, Whitley, want that aspect. And you've said this, and I think you say this in A New World. Something's unpredictable about human beings, and that's of interest to these creatures. And I think Linda touches on it in her essay where she talks about the soul truth, that our soul brings us to an equality with these, whoever they are. We are sentient, even though we don't know it. And this puts us on equal ground in some levels with who's ever out there, the visitors, whatever you want to call them. They may be superior in intellect, in their technology, but, and this is my feeling too, we are equal in the inner depths of who we are as human beings. Do you feel that?
Well, I'm very conflicted about the degree of equality in this sense. I think that some of them do desperately need something here, and that's why they're here. I think that they've used something up. Maybe it's a state of wonder that they've used up. I go into this in a new world, but my experience of them is that they want very badly to commune with me, but not on a level that I can perceive. They want to be silent witnesses within my journey through time. And I think that is, they are hungry for that, hungry for it, because I think that they find the universe terribly claustrophobic. I think they are in a state of claustrophobia. And another thing that we recently saw, I saw an article, in fact, it's a paper in a scientific journal, about human transport through wormholes, that this is actually would be possible. And it's not theoretical. And not only that, the materials that would be needed to create such a device exist. They're not hypothetical. Now, if we think we know that now, it could be that they are walking from one part of the universe to another in a single step. And what does that mean? Does it? It means that they are trapped. They feel trapped here. And they must. And when they're inside a human being with us and living our life with us, they are experiencing the world through the eyes of wonder, which is how we experience it.
Which is what Linda starts her essay off with when she's looking at the moon.
She's exactly. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, in Linda becomes very biographical in ways that she doesn't usually present in her. And she's talking about swinging in her playground, looking at this incredible object in the sky, and filling her childhood mind with what's out there. What is this thing that is so much a visitor into our world? And that sets her off, I think, for the next 60 whatever years on a search for the mystery that has been planted in her from childhood. And the same thing for me and you, maybe. I always wondered, why is no one looking at the stars? Why am I the only one saying there are there's something out there? There are beings. These are porch lights in distant neighborhoods that we are a part of. So this
is that was not true in my neighborhood. We were obsessed with the stars. Oh, yeah.
Oh, really?
Oh,
I was
absolutely.
The only one.
The father of one of us was involved in a big UFO incident, the Levelland, Texas UFO event. And we just, as one of my boyhood friend said, we just lived and breathed this stuff, which we did.
You know, I want to start a little bit back at the beginning. Do you see the title of the book, Making Asterisk Contact?
Yeah, sure. Making Contact, absolutely.
No, but in between the making and the contact is an asterisk.
I was going to ask you about that asterisk. And folks, what we're going to do right now is we're going to take a break for the Free Dreamlanders. You're going to enjoy the break because it is going to inspire you to do whatever we tell you to do, and you will magically go and do it. In the meantime, subscribers will just keep on keeping on because we know you're already inspired. We'll be right back. UnknownCountry.com. It's huge. It's much more than just a Whitley Strieber book site. It contains thousands of hours of interviews, meditations, podcasts of all kinds. My original hypnosis tapes are there. You can actually hear the moment that I discovered that I, at least, was not alone in this universe in the office of Dr. Donald Klein so many years ago. Whitley Strieber audiobooks, Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, Breakthrough, Majestic, and so much more, powerful meditations, but more even than all that, it is a community of people who are either looking to gain contact or actually in contact now. There is no community like it in the world. It is absolutely unique. Contact really is happening here. That's what these shows are all about. That's what my life and this website are about. It's real, and it can be of enormous benefit to us individually and to mankind as long as we take our part and do it our way. This is what being a member of Unknown Country is about. So go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today. Join us and join, very frankly, the future. We're back and we're talking to Alan Steinfeld, his book, Making Contact. And before we left the air, he was about to tell us about the cover, which you are looking at right now. What is that asterisk all about?
That asterisk is the key to making contact. That is a symbol. And that is what I call, and it's sort of inspired by your book, symbols are apprehensions of meaning. They're not comprehensions. Well, I had to fight to get that asterisk in there. And if you look at the hard copy, it's at the top of every single page. Making asterisk contact. So I ask everyone in the introduction, it comes from the Greek idea of poesis, which means to make. Making is an abstract creation of coming from the unknown into the known. So I ask people, what does that asterisk mean to you? What does that symbolize to you, Whitley? If you look at that, what could that mean, that point with all those rays shooting out? What, do you have an intuition of what that might talk to? Why that is so important, and why I had to fight for that to get the publishers to put that in the cover? I mean, really, they said, "What is the big deal?" I said, "That symbol of that asterisk is the whole point of what we bring to making contact. Symbols are the abstract way we feel reality around us. They're not defined like signs. The difference between a sign and a symbol is that there's something infinite about symbolic meanings. It's an apprehension of reality as opposed to comprehension of reality. And the difference between comprehension and apprehension is when you comprehend, and I talk about this in parts of my book, you collapse the wave function. When you comprehend something, your left brain says, this is what it is. When you apprehend something, like a symbol, you're saying, well, it's this. That asterisk means a star. It might mean the point of contact. It might mean a point inside our minds that light up. Symbols are a vague, apprehensive quality to the aspects of nature, to the world around us. It's not, when you don't collapse, when you stop collapsing the wave function into this is reality, we get closer, I feel, to the way the visitors, as you call them, interpret reality. Does that make sense to you?
Yes, it does. It makes a lot of sense. And I think the key to the asterisk is this word apprehension. Mm-hmm. Because when you're reading a book and you see an asterisk, you look deeper. And this is asking us to look deeper. And in a sense, the feeling of unease that we all have, that Linda certainly has, that I have. I remember when I first met Linda, she came to the cabin right at the beginning, right after Communion was published. It hadn't been out for a month when Linda got in touch with me and wanted to come to the cabin. And she came. And we talked about, it may have been actually a little longer than that. I don't remember. She probably has the date written down somewhere. But it was not long in any case. She responded very quickly to the book. And she came to the cabin. And we talked about souls. And we talked about the eating of souls, frankly. And I know, I understand this much more now. And what it is a hunger to share our experience. And that was why I intuitively called the book Communion, or Anne, I should say, intuitively called it Communion. My title was Body Terror, which not quite as good. In any case, it's about sharing. It's not about things being taken from us, although there are entities out there that, in my opinion, do just that. And they are a problem. They are definitely a problem. But the ones that matter to me, and I think the ones that we need to cultivate a relationship with, are the ones who wish to share. Because that goes both ways. They will share in my life what they take from me, is they live my life with me. Mm-hmm. What I get in return.
Live your What I get in return
is knowledge. They trade knowledge for experience.
I think what we also get in return with these beings is this ability to think abstractly, this ability to think within the symbolic realm. I just want to read a quote getting back to what you're saying. Johann Goethe says, a symbol is a living, perceptible, and instantaneous revelation of the unfathomable. So that is what it is, undefinable. And I think this is living with these beings. It's undefinable. It is not something we can put in a box, and we will never be able to put this into a box. Getting back to what your first question is, how is the government going to explain that? They're not going to explain that. They can explain the abstract. They don't have the facilities. We need to evolve, and you've said this, of course, as a culture, to understand the apprehensible realms, not the comprehensible realms, but the things that take place in many levels of awareness. As soon as we collapse the wave function and say, this is what it is, it's never that. The ETs are never what we've defined them to be, because they're not anything we know, right?
Well, you know, that's a terribly important statement. Mm-hmm. Terribly important, folks. Listen up carefully. What Alan just said is critical to everything that will unfold in the human future, because he spoke of collapsing the wave function, deciding what this is. And when you do that, you lose it. You lose everything if you make that decision. If you turn this into a system of beliefs, it's gone. Gone.
That's exactly right. So people are afraid of the word apprehensive, but it just means multiple possibilities. This is how quantum computers work. Do you realize that? Let's take the example of rolling dice, and you get the dice lands and you collapse the wave function and you say it's a 7, but when you're in the process of rolling, the multiple final results are at least 36. So quantum computers calculate the probabilities, the superpositions, not the end result. That's the difference. That will increase the potential of unfolding information 100,000-fold when we calculate the probabilities of being. And this is the essence of quantum physics. And this is the essence, I feel, of using our minds to superposition, to use our imagination to superposition many possibilities. This has been our salvation as a human race, as a species, to postulate what is over that mountain. What if I build this building? What if I create this sunrise here, this picture? This has opened us up and separated us from the other animals on the planet, the possibility yes. for abstract thinking and to contemplate other scenarios. This has been our salvation. And this is what I feel the visitors are pulling us towards. We want to know what everything is. We've only functioned. That's only the left side of our brain. If we open up to the apprehensive qualities of many possibilities, we are now, I feel, more in touch with how these beings are communicating with us. This is one of the things Linda talks about when one of these soldiers stood in front of one of the whistleblowers stood in front of these ETs. He said it was like 7 feature-length movies running through his mind, overlaid with golden letters, and he couldn't comprehend any of it because it's not comprehensible. It is apprehensible. This is what I'm trying to get at with in my essay there. So I hope that helps. It's an
extraordinary essay, folks, by the way. Obviously, Alan is an extremely brilliant man, and you're listening to one of the best descriptions of where we have to go that I've ever heard. And you're going to be free Dreamlanders. You're going to be listening to some other equally important descriptions of something you probably won't do, but do it anyway. We'll be right back.
You start to ask the question, it unfolds the fabric of space itself, how it's made. What is it made of?
We're not alone in this universe. We never have been.
Alien intelligences have cohabited with us on this planet for millions of years.
We inherited the obsession from the Anunnaki.
Anyone that still thinks that we're the ones that are obsessed with gold does not know enough about the true history of our species, how we came to be here,
and the conditions that brought us here.
We are not unique in this universe. Extraterrestrials do exist. We are, so to say, the copies of them.
My new book, Jesus, A New Vision, is not a Christian book. It is not an anti-Christian book either. Very much not an anti-Christian book. It is new, genuinely new. A look at Jesus in his life and what happened afterwards, his resurrection. For the Shroud of Turin is no medieval forgery. It goes all the way back, and it does record an extraordinary event that appears to have been a body transforming into a form of coherent light. The science is very strong at this point. And yet, how could that be? What an extraordinary mystery. The life of Jesus is mysterious indeed. But the greater part of the mystery is about us. How is it that a human body could transform in that way? Who accomplished it? Why did it happen? What does it mean to you and me about our lives now? Jesus, A New Vision, a new window into a very old way of looking at the truth. A way of finding ourselves, perhaps, that we lost a long time ago, but can recover. Jesus, A New Vision is available in Kindle format as a paperback, in audiobook format on Audible and Apple, and as a Kindle and paperback on Amazon. Do go and get it today. We're talking to Alan Steinfeld. His book, Making Contact, boy, is it important, because it's an assembly of the best thinking, frankly, of all of us in the field. Let me just list the authors of that Alan has found: Nick Pope, Grant Cameron, the Hertogs, J.J. and Desiree Hertog, Linda Moulton Howe, John Mack, Whitley Strieber, Henrietta Weeks, Daryl Anka, Mary Rodwell, and then an interview with Carolyn Corey, and Alan's own extraordinary essay, Extraordinary Actuality, My Journey to the Stars. And what you get out of this is a really broad vision of contact, ranging from, oh my goodness, in so many different directions, that it is the book is itself a quantum indeterminate machine, which is remarkable.
I go from the exo to the esoteric, from the external. And this is what we talk about as far as government, what the government knows, what the hardware is. That's the external realm of the phenomenon. But the real essence, as you know, Whitley, it's the esoteric. It's what that experience, the interaction affects our human state of awareness. That's the esoteric aspect. But we need both. We need both to satisfy the those people that function maybe just externally, or some people are deeper internally. So that you're exactly right. It is the complete, I feel, history of and condensed of the UFO investigations the last 75 years. I mean, and I try to bring out parts of it. Yes.
Something worries me a lot. And that's this, the entire, all five principles in TTSA, in the Two to the Stars Academy, Hal Puthoff, all of them, refused to interview with me on Dreamland. Hmm. The group, as a group, they refused. They discussed it together, and they refused. Jim Semivan,
Chris Mellon.
What's his name? Yeah. Chris Mellon, and the other three. The other
Luis Alexander.
I'm forgetting their darn names, and I'm sorry about that, folks. But
no, it's okay. I think Luis Alexandro is definitely a central figure there.
Yeah, well, and Luis Alexandro, it was a no. They all refused to, and it worries me. And then I've seen what could be the beginnings of some social engineering going on. For some unknown reason, a few weeks ago, the New Yorker published a long complimentary article about Elizabeth Loftus and her theories about false memories. And a website that I have thought from some might be somehow associated or getting information from the intelligence community, published a long essay about how hypnosis creates false memories. And then you had Michio Kaku repeating the same warning that has come from major scientists and physicists before: getting in touch with ET is a terrible idea. Now, what is going to happen here? Is it going to be that all of these people who are experiencing contact and thinking about it and talking about it are about to be thrown under the bus by a media juggernaut? Could that happen instead of what you're talking about?
Well, that is why I had to get John Mack in there. I got an unpublished essay by John Mack, who was the head of the psychiatry department at Harvard. He interviewed hundreds of abductees, and he stated And he's probably one of the most important people in our field, said these people are not crazy. They are having real experiences. You know this. And so
yes.
I felt in order to make this book complete, to make it legitimate, I needed to get something from John's archives. And this is an unpublished essay, so people reading this by John will never have read this before. And he only wrote two books on the subject. So that's one aspect. Making contact is not something the government is going to tell us. It is and you know this, it is an internal movement. It is up to us to make contact. If we relied on those of authority to tell us what reality is, we'd all
but
be living in little boxes. And we do. But we have broken out. You've broken out. And that
I've
is why.
I've broken out and you've broken out. But they're going to try to close it. I'm convinced. I'm not convinced. I'm hoping this doesn't happen. But I'm very concerned that they might be planning to try to slam that door in our faces and lock it. Because look at it this way. What if Fox News, well, I don't know if Fox News would do this after, because they've had a very different approach to this than the others. They might persist in saying there's something to this. But CNN, MSNBC, CBS, ABC, NBC, all of them will follow suit. Again, there's a possibility that the New York Times won't. A few days ago, there was a story in the New York Times about close encounter witnesses that was not at all derisive. Derogatory. It was very much more searching, and so we have a situation here that's very complex. And the Elizabeth Lofton article worried me because it sounds like they're just getting ready to fire off cannons, and we're in the line of fire.
Well, but look at you blow their cover, Whitley. That is what you do. Because if we look at how the whole UFO disclosure has been rolling out since December 16th, 2017, we got these videos of maybe 10 or 15 years ago. There's no prior history. It's like the government is just discovering what this is. This is sort of what Alessandro and To the Stars and the ATIP program are saying, wow, we're just realizing there's something here. If you go into abductions and people saying they've been taken and implants, that blows their cover. That is not the scenario they want to lead the public with. They want to say, well, and we're discovering these things along with you. We don't know what's going on, but it just seems to be happening now. And we're going to get to the bottom of this. So they can't talk to you because you're going to expose the dark, dirty secret that's been going on for 75 years.
Well, that's what's worrying me. They're going to be pretending that this is all something new. If they do that at all, I think the first line of defense is probably going to be to say, oh, well, these people are all having false memories. But that won't last. It won't last because there's too much evidence. Well, like, for example, there's buried evidence that could be regained. All of the implant work that Dr. Roger Lear did. I've got a lot of the reports in my file cabinet. I have a piece of the material.
They're not – they are unfolding this in a very calculated way. If you even look at the testimony – of Chris Mellon and Luis Alessandro, say they've been asked, are there ships in the government possession? And they say, well, we don't know. We can't say. But in the July 23rd article, July 23rd, 2020, Ralph Blumenthal, Leslie Keene, they talk about Eric Davis briefing members of the Senate Intelligence Committee on crash retrievals. It's right there in the New York Times. And then you talk to, then you hear Mellon and Alessandro say, well, we don't know if there's anything there. If we have anything, we can't say. And it's in the Times a year ago. So they.
But they didn't read the Times, apparently. I noticed that little disparity. I mean, I'm not going to criticize them. I think they're trying hard to do something that is essentially going to turn out to be impossible. What I think they're trying to do is to make sense of this in some way that that doesn't leave the public where the rest of where us close encounter witnesses and observers, close observers already are, which is in that state of indeterminacy you talked about earlier. And by the way, folks, just before we go on, I mentioned that New York Times article. It was on April the 12th, 2021. It is entitled, As New Yorkers Keep Heads Up, UFO Reports Are on the Rise. And it does not anywhere say that these sightings and experiences are nonsense. Mm-hmm. Nowhere.
You know, look at, let's talk about Essay 2 by Grant Cameron. And he says,
yeah, please let.
The government seems to be doing exactly what the ETs are doing, which means they give us a little bit, they appear, they disappear. The government gives us a little information, they take it away. The UFOs seem to materialize out of nowhere. There's massive sightings, and then they disappear for an amount of time until they come back. So he says they are both in cahoots, in a sense. The government, who's ever running the government, and these ETs want a slow rollout of these possibilities in order to integrate the experience within the human population. And he says it's really there. He calls it the theory of wow, to wake us up. Like, wow, there is something more than just our mundane reality. I don't necessarily agree with that conclusion, even though I included it. I think there's a lot. I wouldn't call it sinister. You might call it sinister. But there is a scene, and I want to ask you about this, Whitley, a collaboration between the appearance, disappearance, the contradictory evidence, the way the government hierarchies are working along with the ET phenomena. What do you make of this parallel realities that we seem to be exposed to?
Well, you get me into an area that I don't talk about very much, but I think it's probably time to talk about it a little more. I am aware of collaboration between the government and entities. I am not aware of collaboration between the Greys and the government, but I am aware of collaboration that ended in the late 90s between the so-called tall blondes and the government. I was witness to some of this, and it did happen. It happened specifically in Boulder, Colorado, in the foothills of the Rocky Mountains over a period of time in the 90s. And it happened in my life. So it was there and it was real. And these people were really strange. And they were, some of them were, well, I'll give you an example of what some of them were like. One of them once showed up. And they were capable of doing all kinds of, like the Greys, they could, you could find yourself in a room and suddenly there they just were. This woman showed up. She was one of these Nordic people. And I was meditating at the time and suddenly there she was sitting before me in a hotel room in the Hotel Kitano in San Francisco. And her presence was so powerful and so, it was like being in the presence of a goddess or an angel. My soul, I left my body to be closer to her. And she looked down at me, not at my physical body, but at me. And I was almost abject and she was so embarrassed. And then two things happened simultaneously. She disappeared, and my little boy came running in from the other bedroom in the hotel, in the suite, saying, Daddy, there's a big silver UFO outside my window. And I realized who it was then. And this kind of what I was looking at, and I could see these diadems on her dress, on her, this white garment that she was wearing, and each one of them was like a living image of, and I know now that they were lives. They were exemplars of her, the lives she had lived. And this was a perfected being, a perfected being. And we will, if God willing, we will have exposure to such beings over the years and centuries to come. And
I think we are those beings, Whitley, in our true form.
I hope so. That,
I feel it. I feel this is
expand
what we're
on
dragging.
That, Alan.
Well, who we really are has never been allowed to shine. We are infinite beings. We have the capacity for non-local intelligence. When I teach remote viewing, I am shocked that everyone gets the target. Sometimes I just give numbers and they get visions. Each one, I've been teaching it for about 5 weeks to this group of 20 people. Everyone, I'd say 80% gets this vision of a non-local sense that they can tune into just by giving them numbers. And Elon Musk wants to implant chips in our brains to make us telepathic. So what is happening is we're graduating from planet Earth. We are waking up to the true capacity of who we are as infinite souls in a dynamic universe. And this is why that New York Times article is out, the increased sightings, because sightings are increasing around the world. And this gets us back to the government question. Why is this all happening now? Because the jig is up, Whitley. UFOs, ETs, whoever they are saying, there's a new vibration happening on planet Earth. And I think it has to do with the COVID lockdown that has allowed us to raise the frequency so we can start to reach into these new realities. And the government is coming forward. They're scrambling to cover their bases and say, yes, we're on top of this situation. But the ETs are saying, this is my, that we're here. We're showing themselves. We're going to show ourselves in increasing numbers because it's time we graduated from this isolation that's, like you said in the show right here, we've been cut off from. There's something that's reigniting, in my feeling, in the human brain with these other levels of reality that is allowing people to have these multidimensional experiences, to allow us to be non-local, more telepathic, more intuitive, more healing. The true expression of the human being and its human potential is coming forward, and we are graduating. This is my hope and sensing of why this book has to come out, why we're having this conversation, why all the hard work you've done, Whitley, is now paying off, even though you don't think
so. All of us. I mean, every single person in this book has made an effort, and the brilliance of the book is you pull together the essential ideas from each one of these people. It's the first time anyone has ever pulled together the real complexity and multidimensional nature of our ideas and our approach to contact. And this, some of this stuff is absolutely wild. It's wild. And whether it's true or not is another question.
But, right. That was the old John Mack statement when he went to Harvard and he said, we don't care if it's true. We still don't believe it, you know. So,
right, exactly.
But this book, though, gives an overview from 11 different perspectives, and that allows the reader to decide what feels true, what makes sense. How does this fit into my belief system? This is what Mac talks about, essentially, is worldviews. This challenges our worldviews. And this is why the government is so afraid of unraveling it all at once, because people don't know what to do when their reality is swept out from beneath our feet, like it has to you, your first contact, 1985. Reality was never the same, and it's a crisis. It's traumatic. That's the trauma, because reality is more solid than the ground beneath our feet. So we are now being slowly nurtured into this awareness that reality is not what it is. When the ATIP says the phenomena is now quantum physics, and that we're no longer talking about objects, we're talking about phenomena, and that is affecting cognitive environments, they're giving hints to how our world is about to change drastically when the visitors show up in increasing numbers. And that is what's happening. And we need to prepare ourselves in the understanding of an apprehensive reality, not a comp. We need to think differently. There's a great quote by John Mack who says, in order to understand this phenomena, we need other ways of knowing. And that is central to the philosophy and the backbone of that book. What are these other ways of knowing? And it is, it's thinking abstractly. It's going into the multiple possibilities that we exist on many levels. That takes me to the third chapter by JJ and Desiree Hertog, who say, we are multidimensional beings. We exist in more than one realm at a time. And they're celestial, he calls them ultra-celestials, ultra-terrestrials, because they're beyond the 3D world. Even though I think most visitors, as you encounter, are not in this physical reality. They're in maybe a parallel physical reality, but there are other beings.
They can project into this reality. I've seen that many times.
Right. But there are other beings that are not of this reality at all. They're pure frequency of energy. They're not manifested here in this realm, but their energetic imprints are sensed by this greater mind. So I keep going back to the fact that there's a greater mind that's unfolding for humanity here, and beyond the five senses that we've been so conditioned to think by. You know, when you're 5 years old, six, you're brought to school and you're taught ABC, 1, 2, 3, and that's all there is to reality. The somatic overlay, as Joseph Chilton Pierce calls it, takes the place of actual reality, the actuality. There's the words, everything becomes a word and a label. And so you never see a tree. You just see the label. When you look at a tree, oh, I know what that is. But if you really stood in front of a tree, you would get the impressions of a being. When you take that label away, when you don't collapse the wave function into, I know what that is.
Yeah, that's for sure. Those are very extraordinary beings.
Exactly. Just like the beings that are appearing through the cracks within our minds, within our frame of reality, they come through the cracks. And because, Whitley, I think you've done those years of meditation, you were somehow attuned to working through, even though it kind of freaked you out, of course, something, the light body that you've been training, maybe not consciously, but with your sensing exercises, is attuned to the meeting of those higher levels of consciousness.
That is getting very much more intense, the light body aspect of that sensing exercise. I have learned using the pyramid text how to turn the body into a light body generator. And so, yes, that is continuing on.
This is what the Tibetans have done. This is building the rainbow body. It's what the Taoists do, building the double. This is the ascension process. I mean, I don't want to get too far out there
exactly
for some people. But we are ascending. You're learning the intricacies of it. So all, in my opinion, all the stuff, all the drama that you've had to deal with in your life is now being brought up to the surface to kind of let go of and erased and flushed down the toilet so you could be
right.
A clear being. so you could live as a light in a multidimensional sense in the light essence that all of us are. That's my feeling.
Well, how do you live?
We're waking up to that we are really light, that we are really infinite possibilities that exist on many levels. And that's the magic of who we are.
How do you live, Alan?
Thank you for asking that. I live in wonder. I live in, and I think maybe it had to do with my past life. I mean, if that's true, I think I was in a concentration camp in Germany, which was not a picnic. And I left that life conscious of coming back in and being a part of a wonderful creation. So my book is very positive because I see it all as miraculous that we are living on this beautiful planet that hopefully we won't destroy, that has incredible resources, that just wants to nourish us if we knew how to take care of it. Every moment is wondrous. So what were you going to say, Whitley?
Well, I think that the reason that this is happening now has to do with the condition of the planet. The visitors, the Greys, have always made it, in my head, made it apparent that this would unfold when the planet needs more help than we can give it alone.
Right.
And what basically is going to happen, I think, as this does unfold, is the people who are in a state of denial about climate change and a state of denial about our ability to do anything about it are going to have to change their tune. And we're going to have to put our shoulders to the grindstone here and save this planet, because we don't have another one and we're not getting one. This is home. This is it.
And we're all connected. We're like the splinter. You have a little splinter in your finger or in your toe. It upsets the whole body. We are the splinter in this cosmic web of consciousness where we're all connected. Our destruction, our disregard, our abuse of this earth and what it has given us is disturbing to the rest of creation. That's my feeling. So,
well, I think it's very disturbing, and especially to people who want to commune with us and who don't have. I have a feeling that we're pretty rare, in the sense that I think that we were changed a long time ago from beings much more like them in terms of our understanding of the way the world worked to something that is fundamentally more innocent. But, and this was done because we have such a rich penetration into the physical world, and that makes us incredibly precious in the sense that others can join us in. I mean, we join each other all the time, and visitors come and join in commune in my being all the time. I'm used to it. They're not taking anything from me. If anything, their presence in my being is a valuable asset. Well, Alan, we're getting to the end of the first hour, and what I would like to do, you mentioned teaching remote viewing. Can you tell us a little bit about how to contact you and what you have on offer in addition to this extraordinary book?
Thank you, Whitley. I do a YouTube series many times a week called New Realities. Look at youtube.com/newrealities. On Facebook at my name, Alan Steinfeld. I am rebuilding my website, even though it's taken a while, newrealities.com. You can email me at newrealities@earthlink.net. It's all new realities to me because this is how we start to cognize a new future. So contact me at any of those places. I'm also Alan_Steinfeld on Instagram. I've just started, I have a podcast on BBS Radio where I'm interviewing different abductees. Actually, I'm going to send us our old interview, Whitley, which is one of the best I've ever done from 2011. Really.
Oh, thanks.
We drop into some very deep spaces there that started to reveal for me the bigger picture of the visitor's situation. And so
when you get into a really deep space, you realize that you're floating. you can levitate. And that levitation is the quantum indeterminacy that is at the core of your own understanding of this phenomenon.
Annie, this is what.
Go ahead.
Yeah. Annie, what? No, this is going to be at the core of all of us. Yes. Go ahead.
She said, the human species is too young to have beliefs. What we need are good questions. And this is the essence of your whole presentation of everything you are.
Right. And I go back to UFOs are not about belief. They're about discovery. That is the key. Yes. And if we could remember that and realize that we're in this world, it's about discovery. We're here to make known the unknown. This is the creative adventure of living, and this is our destiny, just become creative beings that unfold a greater picture of reality, each one of us. That's what I'm excited about.
Free Dreamlanders, I urge you to get Alan's book, Making Contact. It's not for sale as this is being recorded, but you can certainly go on Amazon and pre-order, and that will help the book. Preparing for the New Realities of Extraterrestrial Existence, an extremely powerful journey through the minds of essentially the group of people who are trying hardest to understand this and whose ideas are way out on the frontier. Brilliantly put together and capped with a wonderful introduction by Alan Steinfeld. Subscribers, we will keep on keeping on right now.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.